discussion on it?
Okay, I'll just start then.
Thank you.
very, very nice Bach. It sounded like Bach, it felt like Bach, fantastic. I wonder if we could delve, if we wanted to Baroque-ify it just a little bit. The amazing thing about Baroque music is that it gets to be very vocal. There's a big emphasis on vocality, which I think you bring out so beautifully. And there's also an emphasis on speech and rhetoric, and it has these kind of dual, these two things going on. I think we could find a little bit more of the rhetoric in it, having more contrasts, different articulations, all that kind of thing. And this particular movement really feels to me like a contrast between disjunct leaps, like the way it starts, boom, boom, that's quite a leap, and then immediately linear, 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 linear. And then suddenly, like in bar three, you get these leaps again. I think we can play with that a little bit and find different articulations, way to bring that out, bring out the characters. Because right now it's really beautiful, it's very vocal, but it's all very smooth. Okay. So I thought maybe the disjunct notes could pop out a bit more. And what might help with that, I wondered if you had a character in mind for this movement, and it could change with every bar even, but even just for the first two bars, if you had a character in mind, because I think that can really help decide what you're going to bring to a movement.
Usually what comes to mind when I'm playing this is like a calm elegance, and that's mostly what I'm going for.
Okay.
I could probably add more.
No, that's beautiful, and I think that really came across. Yeah. I agree with that completely. But I think if you're speaking to someone in a calm and elegant way, you want to get your point across, and you're still going to emphasize certain things within that calmness, and I think we could maybe explore that a little bit with this. So even the very beginning, the way it leaps to this high E flat, and then it descends down. I wonder if we could just maybe follow that shape a bit more. Bum bum, you know, just that, even that E flat scale, just getting that kind of shape, this like cascading shape. So that's what I would maybe explore in this piece. I don't know, what are your thoughts on it?
Well, if you like, we can do the first two bars and see if you can play around with it, and then I'll give some more ideas.
Sounds good. So I like what you set up, and then in three you could maybe turn it and go into a different character, so suddenly more searching.
Okay. So these pieces are everybody's friend, right? I mean, every instrumentalist who doesn't play cello is insanely jealous that you guys have these amazing pieces. And we, you know, play them on, steal them on our instruments, and, you know, dive into this music, because this music is friend for life. You can play this your entire life, and you will have different ideas about it throughout your life, which is really cool, right?
Yeah.
So you can play these pieces in many, many different ways. Obviously, it's played by one instrument. So one of the things that you can think about is the harmonies, even though you're just one instrument. So if you were to imagine a bass line with what you're playing, what are the important notes in your figures? You know, when are they bass notes and when are they melodic lines? So that's one way that you can look at it. And you can look at within the phrase, and I thought you brought your phrases up very nicely. Within the phrase, how does that harmonic pattern develop? Because you don't want to spend it all in the first two bars, right? You have a whole piece to think about. And so I think you brought some of that out in your high points very nicely. But that's one thing you could maybe think about is which notes are bass notes, which notes are rhetoric notes where you jump out and you do something different, which notes are just nice consecutive lines. When there is a jump, why is a jump there? Because, you know, what is Bach asking you to do there? And with Bach, you always want to think about jump. I think that ties into what you're saying. For me, the first note is a little too important. I don't hear it as an upbeat right now.
Okay.
So I understand you want to go for it as smooth and calm, but I think if you think of it more as a lead note going to that E flat, that might help.
Okay.
You want to try it?
Sure.
Or anything, it was nice.
Okay.
And we made it very clear that that first note was not important, but the second one was. And it was even more important because it was a leap. It was not going from a B flat to a C. You know, it's a big gesture. So think about gestures. Do you know what a gesture means?
Sort of. I hear it a lot, but I'm not entirely sure.
Okay. Have you ever seen an Italian movie? So Italian people, when they talk, you think they're, you know, horrible things happen, and all they're saying is, you know, saying they went to the store to buy some bread. But next time you see an Italian movie, you see what they do with their hands.
Okay.
And Bach was German, but gestures in Baroque music is very much about bringing your ideas out and emphasizing. What you want to bring out. So bom, pi, that is E flat and more important than a B flat. And then surprise, it goes nicely down. Now looking at bass notes, I think in bar three, you have that low A flat. That's kind of an important one. And then the next one, where do you think the next one is?
Measure four, the G.
Very good. And there's one before it, sorry.
Oh. Would it be the F on would it be the D right before the G on the second beat of measure four?
Oh, sorry. So the low F in bar four is very well done. And the middle of bar three, the A flat, and I forgot when there was one before that, before the A flat. Sorry, I wasn't clear.
Is it the G on measure three?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Makes sense.
So if you think in the back of your head, the low G, the low A flat, going to the F as your baseline, then the other things, the jumps sit above that.
Okay.
So why don't we try from bar one to the downbeat of bar five? And see if you how that feels.
Okay.
Because there's a lot of sequences in Bach, if you're familiar with. Do you know what a sequence is?
It's like a musical idea that repeats.
Exactly, yeah, and it's usually either ascending or descending.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so often when it ascends, you'll do a crescendo, and when it descends, you'll do a diminuendo, but you can play around with that. It doesn't have to be like that. But I think there's so many sequences, and I think maybe bringing these color changes to those could be really nice as well, just to bring out a bit more gesture, like Hanukkah said. I need to identify sequence. Let's see. There's a good one in the second part. Mm-hmm. start more in 33 and then less in 34, or the opposite, but just to have a bit more contrast between them.
Okay.
So like in 39, dum ba da 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 dum ba dum bum, bringing out the A to the G flat could be interesting with just a little bit of time.
Okay.
I don't know if you'd like to give that a try, like from
39, if you wanted to hold that longer, that'd be perfectly fine. Nobody's telling you to have to go on. So you have to, you know, all the, especially the bar two, sorry, beat two or bar 39 is very special, right? But the G flat, your ear absolutely does not expect that. And then you think, okay, on the third beat, okay, everything is well on the D, but then it goes up to the high C, which is the seventh. But he floats on it, and you play it very floaty, which is nice, because then you start thinking about going towards the end. So enjoy that moment, that floating moment.
Okay.
You want to try it one more time?
Sure.
Just surprise us with as far as you dare to go, and if it goes too far, then you'll know.
Those structural points already kind of in front of you. So just pinpointing the places you really, that are like really wild or that you'd want to do really soft, but kind of the special bars to really bring them out, just to go through and circle those. Sometimes I find that helpful. That way in the performance, you just have those little visual landmarks. So that might be a bar, for example. Yeah, I don't know. Would you have another bar in mind that you might want to bring out in either the first or the second part that would be very, like, kind of climactic for you?
So just in the piece? in general. I'd say measure 22 and the moments leading up to that is kind of a big climactic point.
Definitely.
I could probably do more with that section.
Yeah, that section, that really grows up to that point, so you can really go far with that. And then suddenly after that chord in 22, what's happening? Where is it going? Suddenly it gets, it changes, and the articulation changes as well. So it's a little bit more searching, it's the harmonies are a bit more wandering. So I agree, you can go really up to that point, and then after, a whole new character.
Bach had the name for when he did D like that, and it's called a Zeufel. You can look it up. and they're like sides, little sides. And I thought the way you brought it up was very nice. And you can play around with it how much space you want between the slurs, D or D. I mean, you see, it depends also on the space where you're playing. But and this is typical in Bach. Versus when he has these longer shapes.
It's a good tool for contrast.
Exactly. Yeah. And I thought in bar 27 you got a really nice color change there. That was beautiful.
Yeah, thank you.
Do you want to try some of that second part? From the B part? Do you want to go through that bar 22?
Actually incredibly helpful already, so.
Yeah, I think just going, really exploring even further and not being afraid to, as Hanneke said, to go for the gestures is an important one. And I think this movement is really all about contrast.
Yeah. Would you like to finish this session by playing the second half for us and, you know, take us on a journey?
Sure. Do you want me to do the repeat, or do you want me to just do the second half without the repeat?
Let's do the second half without the repeat.
Okay.
And see how far you dare to push it. And if it goes wrong, don't worry about it.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I
the spots you chose based on the harmonies, based on the character changes. It's structured exactly the way I love it, so I loved it. I'm just wondering, this Parakeet is a very dramatic one, obviously, and
yeah.
I feel like all the movements, they're just pushing towards the Shekhom.
Yeah.
And even, in this first bar, you go from the G string on that C sharp up to the E string. It's just these insane, you can just feel the, not to be too Hollywood with it, but like the emotion that's just boiling under the surface in this movement, and it's going to come out in the Shekhom. Do you mind if I just demonstrate a couple of things?
No,
perfect. I'm just wondering, and it plays a little bit also into the fingering figures, which I don't mind at all. I mean, I'm a broker, so I do more things on the open strings. But I think maybe it could just open up more and use the expanse of all four strings. Sometimes maybe not going up in position quite so much.
Okay.
But just for this first bar, which really sets the tone, I'm just wondering. Human and very faulted, very fragile, very emotional, and so I think this first part really had this whole range, and then you have the whole emotional expanse. So that was one of my comments, and then just one other picky thing, and then I'll stop playing. I love, so in bar A, I love that you push forward with this dancey figure. I love that, because it's a whole new character, suddenly it's something else. I think you could use it to launch into a quicker tempo so that you can do this under the printed slur.
Okay.
It's such a shame to break it, because it really is, if it doesn't sound that loud, it's fine, because again, it's really like when you can hardly, say something, you can hardly get the words out. So I think you could push the tempo a little bit.
Okay.
bar 14, when you go up to the high D, that's completely in juxtaposition, in contrast with the begin, which is at the low D. And I think you can go, you went up in dynamic and it was dramatic, but I think you could go 100 times more for it, going up with a high D, and then with the little tag at the end, it comes down back into like, you know, calmness there. But I think really going for it, the, having the G sharp, da 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 da, it's such a, it's such a plea, it's such a cry. So I think you can really go for that 100 times more, and then the repeat when you come back to the low D is going to be so incredible.
And it might help in the first part of the bar 14 to think the gesture through a little bit more so that it moves more. And then, you know, go up to that high D so that it doesn't get stuck there. And then after that high D, you bring it down, your big diva moment, right? Or the male version of that. And then the triplets, they can be much lighter. You're starting to wind down towards the end there. And Bach uses rhythms in a very interesting way. Sometimes a triplet can be super important, and sometimes it's just like waterfall.
That's true, and that's the, you know, a rare spot in a triplet. I mean, that's the first time we have, oh no, we have it as a game, but that's true, it does kind of bring attention on.
Do you want to show the big opera moment?
And then the second part is a whole new character.
Right.
It's suddenly a bit more hopeful or something. It's on the E string. It's completely, completely opposite from the A part. Yeah.
I had one more suggestion, if you don't mind. In bar 11,
okay.
You have that D, beep, 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 beep. And I'm not a violinist. So maybe I'm asking for something that's super hard. And I apologize. But that last note that isn't under the score, sir, I would like that to be a little bit lighter.
Okay.
Because it's the higher one anyway, so you hear it.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't need to be stressed in any way.
Okay.
Is that hard to do?
I think it's definitely doable. I think I'm just trying to compensate for the amount of bow I'm using on the slur versus that last separate note.
Sure.
But I can definitely get that figured out with a little bit more practice. I don't know about right on the spot.
Okay, no worries.
I'll definitely work on that.
Yeah,
you can definitely shorten that note and travel through the air. So
okay.
And you can take time in the air on it.
Okay.
So that you really have the time to. Yeah, but that's the thing with Bach. There's always, there's a lot of air travel. It's air management. Do you want to give it a try?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
It definitely needs more practice, but...
Well, and you are doing it, of course, on a modern bow versus a baroque bow. That would be easier for a bow, for sure. Even I know that, not you. to my ear, sometimes I'd like to hear a little bit more travel, meaning I can hear your phrasing very
lines are very long.
And that might also be a difference between a modern violin and a Baroque violin, that might be a little bit harder to do on a modern violin. Because I feel like sometimes you're really going for a beautiful sound, which is, of course, amazing, but it loses a little bit the gesture in the phrasing.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Maybe you can...
No, I think that the times you do are really beautiful, but sometimes they're maybe just a tad too much. Like bar 27, I love that you bring out this high A, but I think it could be done more with color and less with time.
Okay.
So maybe things like that will help keep the movement going. And I think this movement, in contrast with the Courante, for example, which really needs to be pretty strict, I think it can ebb and flow a little bit, but not in a way that's distracting or going to break it up, but in a way that will give that kind of long phrase feeling.
Okay.
So like what we did in bar 10 with the long slur, that kind of thing is really helpful.
Mm-hmm.
I think I agree. I think in the second part, maybe you lost a little bit of the overall arc because there's just so much more going on harmonically in it. I think you wanted to take time on those things, which is nice. But yeah, I think pushing forward a bit more is that's a good point.
Okay.
So keep the musical thoughts, but maybe a slightly different tool.
Okay.
Maybe doing more with color, and like Hanka was saying before, with bass notes versus upper stuff that can really
you were doing a lot of that already.
Yeah.
Should we look at the second half?
Yeah, I think
that's
the
harder
idea.
One.
Do you want to play just with that in mind, play through some of the second half, like maybe through, I don't know how much time we have yet, maybe through the second half and see how that feels, just thinking about that longer arc. Idea of it as well. So I think with dynamic we can bring it out more, but here this, we already know what harmony this is. So we don't need to hear each note because we know where we are. So we can travel through those. And here you took some nice time, but maybe it's a little too much.
third beat, that E natural. What is it doing there? Why is it there? Where do you think it's part of or not part of?
I think in the long term, if you go towards the resolution on the third beat of 27, I think it kind of sets it up as a leading tone to that point.
Exactly. So I think it's a little more important than the way you're playing it. Right.
Okay. Now. Is that an open string moment there?
Sure is. Definitely. And then it'll harken back to that first bar, which is pretty cool. Yeah. And just preceding it, 24, 25, this sequence. These are the harmonies. When you hit the harmony notes, those are important, but the rest of the notes are throwaway.
Okay.
So I think it's a little too, that part maybe was still a little bit too.
Yeah.
Each note was too beautiful.
Yeah, I felt that one.
You can add more ugly notes.
And also when there's the important notes and then the less important notes within those, you have consecutive ones and ones with jumps.
Mm-hmm.
So why are they like that? Why are there jumps? Why are they consecutive? Make them different.
Okay.
And just a small caveat at the end of 22, not to slow down within the triplet.
Yes.
There's something about it. Sounds a little funky. Should we hit all those things there in those bars? Like,
okay.
If you want to go from, I don't know where it's good, like from 22?
Okay. Just with an open mind, whatever I can get, because I'm putting this on a program with romantic music, so the more Baroque input I can get, the better. I didn't have any specific questions in mind, so.
Great.
I appreciate everything you've told me so far, so thank you so much.
It sounds beautiful.
Pleasure. So when you do it on the same program with romantic music, you're going to have to really put on a different hat.
Yeah.
That's a very
I plan on opening my recital with this music, so I can go into it with that mindset.
Yeah.
Are you starting the program with it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, that helps.
I'm going to do the first four movements of this partita and then follow.
Yeah, I've heard the other, I've heard some other ones, but I'm not, like, super familiar with the genre. Exactly.
Right, okay. So it's a dance.
Right.
And it's a dance that has more weight than what you're giving it right now.
Okay.
And I think just looking at your body, it might actually help if you are a little bit more on the backside of your feet and of your hip. You're leaning a lot forward, and maybe that's for you to, you know, get away from your modern violin and thinking more Baroque. But I think it's working against you in this piece. So find yourself a little bit more grounded on the ground. That's way easier said than done, especially in front of other people. But, you know, take a deep breath and feel your hip, feel your knees, feel your feet, and bring that in that piece, regardless of, you know, all the notes that you have to play. And then for practicing purposes, I think it might be helpful to not always play all the notes in your practice session. So think about, can you just play the melody line, or can you just play the bass line? And think about which notes are important, which notes are supported, and find the line of the phrases within that. Because right now I feel like you're spending a lot of energy with these horrible crunchy chords, and they are hard. But I think in order to get back to the music, it's good to simplify it first and then see where does it go from there, and then fold in those hard. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, definitely. I agree. And yeah, 100%. It's beautiful. I mean, this is the hardest piece in the whole set, I would say. And to get up and play it after waiting, listening, I mean, bravo. That's awesome. I agree. I think Allure is a heavy dance.
Okay.
And Bach is a German composer, but we know he had a lot of French influence in his writing. And this piece, it really takes me to the French court. I see Lully conducting. I don't know if you know about Lully and his stick.
Yeah.
I see the stick. And I want to hear it. And I think that can help technically as well. You have an amazing, super relaxed technique. I mean, I'm so jealous of your left hand. So I think the chords are easy for you, but I think the right hand can really help you out. Because right now everything is very fluid. So you're not taking any silences to help set the left hand.
Yes, okay.
But I think the right hand can be just as strong. Obviously we need a strong left hand for double slaps, but I think the right hand can be just as strong. And that kind of ties into the French interpretation of it as well. So I think something a bit more pronounced. I love what you did. I mean, the sweet side of it. If you want to do that,
with the rhythm.
gets away from the dance. It's not like they were pieces that were danced on, but they're rooted in the dance.
Okay.
So,
right. Yeah, stylized.
Yeah. I was hearing a lot of air, which was good.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
a whole different mentality than I had going in. Yeah. I was looking at the dotted quarters and I was treating them very like much like a taper. Is that appropriate or should I play through those more? I guess is the question with this.
I tend to taper them, but you could go either way, I would say.
On a Baroque bow, it automatically tapers.
Yeah, that's the thing.
This is true.
This piece, sorry. It's just so harmonically charged, so I think you could play around with it.
Okay.
It's been so long since I played it. Like the first one, because you're just setting E major, I would definitely say taper. But this one is more interesting, so maybe you could. That's an appoggiatura with a slur, so I would hold that. So I hook. Here I love doing, tying these two slurs together. Often you could do, and then a Lombard. So it's really
in a go.
Yeah, a little bit of in a go.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like, wait, sounds wrong to me.
Yeah, and I would definitely do an up-o.
Okay.
And then another up-o. So playing with the body a little bit, but I think your upbeats need to be up-o, but this also, because it's a throwaway, needs to be up-o, so I would do an up-up.
Okay, so.
Yeah. For me, that comes on my butt down bow.
Oh.
Yeah. Nice. And why go to third position?
Because it's music. No. I felt like it was a lighter effect than like a E string.
I can see why you think that, but actually the color change of going up on the A string for me puts a lot of emphasis on it because
okay.
I hear such a difference in tone. So I think if you want it to be weak, it's easier on the E string. There's something about that that just, I don't know, it brings it out more to me because it's so lyrical suddenly. So I would keep it on the E string.
Okay.
And it's easier too. So.
So.
Yeah, exactly. So, and then getting in here, I think maybe you could hold the, you could taper a little less because it's more songful. If you wanted to, yeah.
And I don't mean to make you play it.
Okay.
I was just confused at that one moment, so I can make things jump now. But thank you for it. So.
Absolutely.
it's a little wispy, so I think really bring it up. If you want a hook, that's fine. But really, yeah,
okay.
Bringing that 16th out.
Yeah, and I would love to look at that. It's hard for me to do like
on the spot.
The spot.
Of course.
Yeah,
of course.
No, I would love to go through and like practice that and figure out. Some
but
stuff.
It will help the music. So
yes.
It'll help you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Eventually.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I think, yeah, what will help determining how you choose is what are upbeats, what are downbeats. Like in bar 10, dum bum, I do a gentle hook, dum bum, to get that chord on up bow. So that the chord starting on the beat is really the strong.
Okay.
The
yeah,
strong
that
beat, since that has an appoggiatura.
Right.
If you have an appoggiatura, which is the note slurred in from above, you always want to bring that out. So for me, this is an upbeat, and this is the strong beat because of the appoggiatura.
Right.
So I hook that. And then the last chord, I think it's nice to roll it. It gives the harmony a nice shape rather than. I have a teacher who calls that the hello chord. But that's how I determine my bowings, is whether which beats are strong, which are weak. Anytime you have an appoggiatura, you want it on a down bow. So the like bar 4, that should be on a down bow. And I hook, because I really want this, which is another appoggiatura, on a down bow.
Right,
yeah,
okay.
So stuff like that. In the second half, I find the harmony, the middle of 19, to be weaker, so I hook into it, I hook here, so it's not as pronounced, but then this one you could do a down down, because it seems stronger,
okay.
You see?
Sure.
So just kind of following the shape of the harmonies. Gentle, stronger, and then that comes out nicely, so it's down, up, up, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
And then that melody can sing.
Exactly. And if you're a little bit stronger, like in bar 19, then you can easily have a lighter contrast, like this little thing after, which is so sweet. So in order for that to sound sweet, you have to be not sweet beforehand.
Right.
So just finding these little contrasts can be helpful.
Yes, wonderful.
Yeah. Do you want to play some of the second?
Sure, from the repeat bar.
Yeah, let's go through bar 15.
From bar 15?
From the start of the B section through 15.
And if it's a hard one, just make the upper tutora longer.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, that's a good idea.
Works musically, works
technically. Okay,
great.
Yes, okay. Would you like me to start from there again? Since I'm approaching that from the bottom, how do I approach the trill from the top, I guess is my question.
That was nice, that was good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
enjoy that moment.
Okay.
And then what's in the middle, it doesn't really matter. Here we go, your fingers
that's
up
the blow.
Okay.
Let's see, we have 1 minute to wrap up.
Yeah, I guess I would say maybe spend a little time with it, kind of maybe revisualizing a little bit the Boeing.
Yeah. Well, I think I also had an error in my like interpretation, so that might have contributed to the error.
No, I mean, interpretation
yeah.
is yours to
exactly
be what you want it to be. So, if you, you know, we're not, we don't want to impose an interpretation.
No, of course not.
It was beautiful.
With the more, I guess, full sound, I think the,
yeah,
the like down down will
helpful.
Be much more crucial.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can play around with it and if you decide to go a different direction, that is perfectly fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
This lore is heavily contested with all with everyone because everyone has a different idea of how it should.
Yeah, I've
so
heard there, several different recordings.
Exactly.
Too,
so
so.
Not to worry.
We should probably just.
Yeah,
well, yes, I wasn't thinking of you in particular.
Hey, he's up. Oh, I see him there.
I can do it. It might not be great, but it can happen.
That's right. Where am I?
Yeah, let me open this up and then. Let's see. We should maybe put. Well, oh, this is a good question. We should have thought about this before. Or I should have thought about this before. I think, Jackson, you should be here. And then,
yeah.
Where she, maybe we want to just push you back a little bit, so we have a little more space. So that view here, how do we want to do this? Let's try it this way. Let's get a little bit closer together, but let's try it.
Too bad, you're first time. I don't think I'll
say this. Just how exciting, why don't we try?
Yeah, let's do it. I think it'll be fine.
that's something that you can't do on a harpsichord, so it all has to come from you.
Okay.
You know, Alice, of course, plays amazing harpsichord. She does a lot with the chords and things and shapes, but the line of it is 100% you.
Okay.
So, have you had a chance to play with just the harpsichord in the line?
I haven't done much. A little bit, maybe, but not very much.
Okay. So maybe that would be good to just take a moment. Sorry to live like this. Because when you have a rock and continuum team, that makes you sound better. So it's very important. which one shall we take a look at? Maybe at the Andante. Because there's some flowing lines there, and there's some, you know, lines where you can play your notes a little shorter and sometimes a little bit more direction. So at the very opening of the Andante, you have the dee dee dee, and then you have a little step. So bring out the step just a little bit, and then you have all consecutive. So you can bring your line in there. And whenever you have the octave jumps, make them short. They are not important, and they're often cadential. So they're definitely not important then. So you can throw those away a little bit. Why don't we do the Andante, just the bass line. Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 bars. I don't know. Yeah, where the cadence is.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Just the two of them?
Yes, just the good two of them.
Just the first phase, and he says six bars.
Okay.
So that is the shape you can achieve with a Baroque bow. The idea behind the Baroque bow being that because of the shape of it, which goes this way instead of that way, everything's going to taper once you get into this weaker part of the bow. And the middle is really your strong, juicy part. And the frog, obviously, is weaker as well because you can't start too harshly, otherwise it's not going to sound good. So you have weak, strong, weak. And that's the idea of mezza voce, is that it's a note that blooms to the middle and then tapers away. You can practice them just on open strings. And any slow movement in Baroque music is going to just be filled with these mezza voces. And so you both have the chance to do them. And what's fun is that your parts will hit, the mezza voce will hit right when you have dissonances against each other. So it's going to create these incredible blooms, which in the modern world is called banana bow. So I think we, instead of tapering, right now it's very tapered. It's a release of tension. And here we want to keep the tension because you're really dissonant against each other. So it's a great point to use the mezza voce. So the strong part is on the dot of your quarter note and on the tie of your note. That's where the strong part of your mezza voce is. I'm exaggerating right now, but that's sort of the idea of it. So that's going to really bring the tension and the line against this amazing bass line, which is just, you know, it moves, boom, 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 and you're floating with these incredible dissonances above. So why don't we give a little bit of that a try, maybe these same six bars?
Thank you.
But in general, I think
these
you
are
could tighten.
What? These are carbon fiber.
So oh, great. Okay.
No worries.
I think you can tighten them much, much more, and
okay.
It's going to help with MS Devote Chase. We really want, we want this, this shape. So there's quite a lot of space between the stick and the hair. You have a different model than I do, so it's not going to be exactly the same, but in general, it can. There's no over tightening. It's not like the.
It's not like a torque.
Yeah, so I think that's going to help just to bring out a little bit more.
And it's good job playing with that between the rest and all of that.
Amazing. Yeah, it's so stable. It's not like, like when I was starting, it was rocking like crazy, but you guys are.
We've got the whole spot.
Actually,
yeah.
I did have a question. I noticed when you were playing, you were kind of more centered in the violin. Are you resting your chin on the tailpiece?
Yeah, I wasn't sure how. I noticed because.
I think we're
you guys have it a little bit out this way, like the modern violin, but what's nice with the Baroque violin is if you do bring it a bit more centered, straight in, you can have a little bit more contact with that area, which is very centering. But everyone is different, every violin is different, so that's just what works for me.
Okay.
But it does have a different connection with the bow that way and with the MS Devote. And I'll often move my violin out as the MS Devote goes and move it back in. It's sort of a, just a kind of movement I do, but everybody's different. Yeah, I have mine a little bit more centered.
Okay.
Yeah.
And most of the time you have it, you know, not with your chin.
Right,
because
so
it resonates better that way.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you want to get into chin off playing, it's also easier. It's easier if the violin is closer to you than if it's out here. If it's out here, I mean, you have no grounding. But if it's here, there's no problem with lifting your chin off. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And then, also, sorry to stack on that question. Do you pitch it differently than you would a modern violin? Like, height, like up or down?
Oh, I see.
I see, like, some people come really quite low.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on
that? Well, I think the whole thing with Baroque violin is that it's very natural, and it's just sort of an extension of the body, and, you know, there's a lot of music that was played down here or down here. So it does kind of sit lower. I don't try to hold it up. There's no more need for biceps. Which is nice. So yeah, just kind of letting it. There's a natural slope down, which I think is normal. But I do tend to lift it up just into the bow when I have long notes and stuff like that. It's because it's freer. We don't have all the paraphernalia on the instrument and chin off. I think you can just in general move it around more than you do with a modern instrument. So I kind of play with that and with the bow, and then, yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah. But yeah, Baroque violins tend to play a little bit lower down than modern violins.
Yeah. I was just curious, like, what the process was behind that. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. Well, if you're doing chin off and you're shifting.
Well, that's the thing. I always am afraid, especially.
Yeah, it's really tricky. It's really hard to do it if you're holding the violin up. So I think having it down just makes it naturally a little easier to shift because you have. A natural gravity coming down.
Sure,
we want to use every trick we can. Gravity helps.
Do you have any other questions? Those are good questions.
Sort of a Boeing philosophy question, actually. I've noticed that sometimes there will be ties over the bar line that I'm not sure how to bow those, like, generally. I've always been taught, like, the downbeat is down bow, right, for Baroque, generally.
Right.
So.
Well, you wouldn't change bow on a tie. You'd definitely keep it in the same bow. And ties usually signify a dissonance. Not always, but there's probably going to be a dissonance on a tie. So, again, it's going to hit in the middle of that mess de voce, that bow. So you want to go towards the tie in terms of intensity.
Okay.
Usually.
And they talk about mess de voce not just for violins, but also for singers. It's, you know, and of course, there's not the physical part of the bow there, but it was an aesthetic in the Baroque.
Should we do some of the fast ones?
Yeah, sure. All right. Let's play some of the fast ones. I thought you played it very, you know, it was very fun to listen to.
Okay.
And then think longer line with that. So it's easy to think about the detail and then think about the long line as well. And I think that'll give some energy and some lightness to it.
Okay.
And everybody has that figure, so it goes for everybody. Shall we try it?
Thank you.
looks like it is Charlie Ogle.
Yeah, mine's the same.
Yeah, I think they're